Hey, hey, it's Tomori here. Welcome to another episode of my tutorial series about making a farm game in Unity, or as you may know it, making HayDay. In this episode we will be starting out with a whole new system in the game, a storage system. It will take a few more episodes to fully develop it because it will involve multiple mechanics in the game, including growing crops, producing goods, and also spending products. We will take a look at how this system works, what instances you will need, and what the relations between them are. We will develop scripts for storage buildings and also a storage manager. By the end of this episode, you will have a storage initialized with items and also the opportunity to increase space in it. This is going to be more of an introductory episode, but very important for our next steps, so stay tuned. To recap, in the previous episode we made a timer for all our processes. It featured a slider to indicate the progress and a text countdown just like you see in the original game. If you haven't seen that video, go watch it now and also the previous episodes. We'll be building on what we've already done. And let's get to the video! First things first, let's take a look at how things work in the original game. In HayDay, you can see two storage buildings that store different items. There is a silo which stores crops and also fruits, and then we have a barn which stores products, feed, tools, etc. Both of these buildings have the same UI which displays item that the player has. Note that it shows even the object that the player doesn't have, but they are available on the current level. We can also see the increased storage button. If we press it, we get another panel with the tools needed to increase the storage, their available amounts compared to the amounts required, a back button and a confirm button. Most of the things we will tackle in this tutorial. Next, we're going to look at what instances we will need to make the storage work. First, we have an abstract scriptable object collectible item. This is the base for all the types of objects we'll have in the game. It will have a few common fields like the name of the object, its description, the level it's opened on, etc. Next, we have a storage manager. It will keep track of all the collectible items in the game, no matter what the type is. It will be communicating with both barn and silo. Then we have a storage building. It will inherit from the placeable object because it can be moved, but not the building script because it is not supposed to have a building time. It will have its own UI window to display items. These are the main scripts that we'll need at this point, but later on we will add a source script that will be used for production buildings, animals, etc. Now, let's bring all of that to Unity. First, make prefabs for silo and barn. I created a prefab for the silo, and for the barn I will be using a prefab that I created earlier in the third episode of the series. You can watch it here. By the way, thanks to Adam for making the silo sprite for me. Next up we have the UI. Since both of the windows for barn and silo are identical, I made a prefab to clone it. It also has another panel for displaying tools needed to increase the storage space. There is a slider at the top to indicate storage fill and a text. Of course, we'll need to create a few scripts to make everything work. I created a folder called storage system for them. Create a script called storage manager, storage building, storage UI and collectible item. Then create another folder inside this called item types. In it, create scripts for all the types of products. I divided them into animal products, crops, feed, fruit, products and tools. Before we get to the coding, I want to remind you that all of the scripts and project files will be available on my Patreon page, so you can skip through writing code from the video. And let's get started on those scripts. Our first goal is to put the prefabs that we have onto the map. But without actually getting them from the shop. Open the script storage building. Make an inherit from a placeable object. In it, create a field for storage UI. Then create a public string property name with a private set. Create a private serialized field for the window prefab. Next, create a method initialize which accepts a string parameter name. In it, initialize the property name with a passed value. Create a variable called window, which is a game object. Instantiate a window prefab, set the canvas as its parent and assign it to the window variable. Call the method setActive on the window game object and pass false to disable it. Then get its component storage UI and assign it to the corresponding field. After this, create a virtual void on click. In this particular case, it doesn't have to be virtual since we won't be overriding it, but I wanted to show you this as an example so you can use it in other scripts. In this method, you can do whatever actions you need to do when clicking on an object, like displaying UI panel or timer tooltip. Then, in UNT method on mouse uppers button, we call the onClick method. This way, if we need to change what the object does when it is clicked, we don't need to write another method on mouse uppers button. Moreover, we can call the base method onClick from an inheriting class. By the way, it has to be protected if you want to do this. Moving on to the next script, storage UI. First, we'll write a bunch of fields for UI. You can just look through them because the names are pretty self-explanatory. Then create a method setNameText which accepts a string parameter. In it, just set the name text to this name parameter. After this, create region buttons. It will group all the methods connected to buttonClick methods. First, we have a close buttonClick which will disable this game object. Second, we have an increase buttonClick which will set the increase window active. Then we confirm buttonClick which we'll fill in later. This is the checkmark button that you saw earlier. And lastly, we have a back button which will disable the increase window and bring back the items. Now, go to the storage building script. In the initialize method, call the setName method on the storage UI. I made a silly mistake and tried to call it before instantiating the panel itself, so don't repeat my mistake and put it at the end of the method. After this, go to the storage manager script. Write a public static storage manager current for singleton. Then write two serialized fields for prefabs. Create fields of type storage building for barn and silo. Next, create a method awake. Initialize the current field with this. In the start method, we will instantiate the object. First, create a game object variable for silo object. Call the building system initialize with object method and pass the prefab and a position where you want your object to be instantiated. However, at this point you will get an error because this method does not return anything. So before moving forward, we need to fix this. Go to the building system script and find the initialize with object method. Rewrite the definition of it to make it return a game object. In the end, return the game object you instantiated. Then go to the placeable object script and create a method load. In it, call the panZoom script and unfollow the object. Then get the drag component and destroy it. Basically, we're placing an object onto the map but skipping the area check. Now you can go back to the storage manager script and finish what you started. Initialize the silo field with the component you get from the silo object. Call load method on the silo and initialize it passing the name silo as a parameter. Then we just have to do exactly the same with the barn object. Go back to the editor. Create an empty game object for storage manager. It has prefab fields, so initialize them with our prefabs. Then go to the storage UI prefab, add a script storage UI and initialize all the fields on it. Don't forget to initialize the buttons with their methods. And lastly, go to the barn and silo prefabs and replace the script building with a storage building, which you created in this episode. Initialize the size and assign the window prefab. Now we can test. We can see that the objects are successfully placed on the map and if we click on them, we get a storage window which we can close using the button on it. The next step is to make the storage window populated with items. Open your script collectible item, make an inherit from scriptable object, and also make it abstract. In it, create a few public properties to describe the item. I included properties like name, description, a sprite icon, and a level which is going to be 0. Head over to the animal product script and make it inherit from a collectible item. Above the declaration, in square brackets, write create asset menu. Pass animal product as a file name, add a menu name to place it under the tab game object storage items. Now we have to repeat this process with the rest of the scripts for item types. Go to the storage UI script. In it, create a method initialize items which accepts a dictionary with collectible items and their int amounts. We will first destroy all the children of the item's content in case it was already populated before. For this, get the child count, go through each of the children and destroy them. After this, go through each item in the dictionary and instantiate item prefab, setting the item's content as parent. Then find the icon, get the image component, and initialize the sprite with the icon. Initialize the amount text with the amount, which you'll also get from the dictionary. About this method, create a public method initialize which accepts an int for the current amount of items and a maximum amount that the storage can hold. Also, it will accept a dictionary with collectible items and int amounts. First, set the max item text to current amount slash the maximum amount. Also, set the slider value to the current amount divided by the maximum amount. Don't forget to cast one of the values to float to not end up with zero. After this, call the method initializeItems and pass the dictionary with the item amounts. Now, go to the storage building script. Create fields for the current total of items in the storage and the maximum amount that can be stored. Also, create a dictionary with collectible items and integers for item amounts. Then add a dictionary parameter to the initialize method. At the end of this method, initialize the items and calculate the item's total. Initialize the maximum amount. Call the initialize method on the storage UI and pass the current total, storage max, and items. Next, go to the storage manager. Create string field called items path and assign a storage string to it. It will be the path to load our resources. Then create a dictionary for animal products. Repeat the same for the rest of the product types. In addition, create two dictionaries for barn items and silo items. After the wake method, create a method called loadItems which returns a dictionary of collectible items and ints. In this method, create a dictionary of items. Then create an array of collectible items, all items, call the resources load all method with the type collectible items and pass the path variable which we created earlier. Go through each element in the array and check if its level is more or equal to the current level of the player. If it is, add the item to the item amounts. I put the number 2 to grant the player some items and show you if the system really works, but you should replace it with 0. After the loop, return the dictionary. Next, create a method called sort which accepts a dictionary of item amounts. In this method, initialize all the dictionaries for all our item types. And also the dictionaries for seal items and bar items. In a loop, go through each item pair in the dictionary and determine its type. I will show you an example how to do this, but you'll continue with the rest of them. Write an if statement. In it, write item pair dot key is animal product and then create a variable animal product. In the if, add to the animal products dictionary. As a key, use the animal product variable and get the value from the item pair. Also, add the same way to the barn items, since this type belongs to it. Repeat these steps for all the types. Go up to the awake method, create a dictionary item amounts and load items into it using the method load. Call the sort method and pass the items dictionary. Find the start method and correct the call of the initialize methods on the storage building, since now they take two parameters. Pass the seal items and barn items. Go to the editor. In the resources, create a folder named storage. In it, create a few collectible items. I created tools since I will be using them for increasing the storage space. Hit play mode and test if everything works. You can see that the items and their amount appearing, so we can proceed further. The last thing we're going to do for this episode is to make a way for the player to increase the storage capacity. In HayDay, every time you increase storage, the item's required amounts get bigger. In your game, you can make a set increment for these values or load them from a CSV file, which I mentioned in one of the previous episodes. Open the storage manager and create a public method getAmount which returns an int. In it, create an int variable for the amount and initialize it with 0. Then write an if to determine the type of the item like we did before. If it is an animal product, call the method tryGetValue from the animal products dictionary and out it in the amount variable. Repeat this process for all types in your game. In the end, return the amount value. Next, create another method that returns the bool and call isEnough of. It accepts an item and the amount. Write return and a condition if the getAmount method returns more or equal to the amount needed. This will be true if the player has enough of that item. Now move on to the storage UI script. At the beginning, create an action field called increaseAction. Find the confirm button click method and invoke this action there. Now create a method called initializeTool which accepts a dictionary of collectible items and their amounts. Create an integer I and set it to 0. Then in foreach loop, go through tools. Inside, get the tool holder with the index I, which we created. Then get the icon, image component, and set the sprite to the one you get from the collectible item. Also, get the amount and initialize it with the amount of the item that the player has, which we'll get from the storage manager. Then write a slash and a number of items needed from the tools dictionary. Now find the initialize method here and add a tools dictionary and action on increases parameters. Call the initialize tools method and also set the action on increase. Move on to the storage building script. Create a serialized list of tools. Also, create a dictionary collectible items for tools. Create a method increase storage. In it, we will first check if we have enough of each item using the method from the storage manager. If we don't, we should return, which I forgot to do at this point. You can also display some kind of message here. After this loop, you have to take these items from player, but we don't have this method yet. We'll write it in one of the next episodes. After this, increase the storage capacity and call the initialize method on the UI. In the initialize method, in the same script, initialize the tools dictionary. In a foreach loop, go through all the items in the tools list and add them to the dictionary. I set the amount to 1 just as an example. Correct the call of the initialize method on the storage UI. Go to the editor and populate the tools lists in your prefabs. Hit play and see if everything works. We can see that in the tools window we have the correct numbers and we can even increase the storage, but for now the amount the player has doesn't change. Looks like we're done for this episode. Thank you for watching. We have the storage buildings, UI initialization, and even tools to increase the capacity of the storage. In the next episode, we're going to be further developing this system, but that's not all. We will also look at other mechanics in the game. I'm not gonna spoil it to you, but it might have something to do with crops. So subscribe to my channel, hit that like button if you enjoyed this video. And don't forget to check out my Discord server, where you can share your work, chat with me and other game devs. I'd like to thank all my patrons and welcome Tintin Lo, Pim, Amaris YRJO, Yoshinori Iwagachi, Daniel Dane, Alan Rodriguez, Ali, Narcis Sabtala Sanchez, Gerbod, Christopher Trower, Leonard Keel, Jamie Shilpad, Martin Agner Dahl, The Night Father, Robbie Strokes, Veronica Harbison. See you in the next video! Bye!